Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Biometrics, Sexy, Secure, and Stupid. My name is Adam Englander. I am the Chief Architect for MFA Products. What that means is I get to make all the decisions about what we do for security, encryption, biometrics for the iovation multi-factor authentication product called LaunchKey. So most people are probably here because biometrics are sexy. It's the hot new thing, right? If you have a mobile app, they want you to make sure it's protected by a biometric. It's in all the news. I get picked to do a lot of presentations about them because everybody wants to know about them because they're fairly new, kind of. So biometrics to me are sexy like a Tesla. So people love Teslas, right? And biometrics to me are very similar because electric cars have been around for over 100 years, but nobody wanted one until the Tesla came out, right? There have been electric American cars that have been sold that nobody would buy. I mean, some people bought, right? We're in California, and if you have a very short commute, right, 30 miles each way, you were perfectly fine. If you had good weather, you were good. But it wasn't super useful for a larger audience, where Tesla found a way to do that. And they also made it look really, really nice, not like a normal electric car. It's something that people wanted to have, and it became a status symbol all of a sudden. Biometrics have been around for 4,000 years. There are clay tablets that you can go see at the British Museum that have thumbprints on them. For people, it's accounting for when they were doing accounting of the businesses, and then the accountant would put his thumbprint there to say, yes, I'm the one who did this. So they've been around forever, and if you've, if you're as old as I am, you've seen a bunch of spy movies where they use biometrics, and so it was used in super high-tech things. They were used by the police, but they weren't used every day. And until they were able to get over some of the flaws and the difficulties in doing it, much like the electric car, they weren't super popular. But they became really sexy when they were able to reduce friction for transactions. Right? If I wanted to say I wanted to protect my ability to purchase something on my phone or make a bank transfer, whatever the case may be, I would have to put in a password, and that would take time, and I had time to think about my transaction. Right? On an impulse buy, I had that extra 2 or 3 seconds to think, which is not what retailers want. They want you to just immediately buy it. And if you could do that really quickly with just showing your face or putting on your thumb, super awesome. It also got people using banking apps more than the website or the call center or even going in to the bank, which costs them money. So making it easier to do it on a mobile device got people to go to mobile apps where they could get more alerts about things were going on, and they would have less expense going out per customer to deal with customer service issues. And because of this, biometrics are now everywhere, right? They're Microsoft Hello, there's facial recognition and fingerprint scan on your iOS device. Depending on your device, you probably have a fingerprint scan on your Android device, and you may have a retina scan on a Samsung device. So it is everywhere. And we're all very comfortable with it today, but I want you to think about something. 5 years ago, none of us used biometrics. 5 years ago, this crazy little button on the bottom of an iPhone 5 showed up. And you started using biometrics in your daily life. Biometrics have only really been around in the public for 5 years, and now it is everywhere. It's hard to find something else that moves so quickly. That's why they're sexy. Another piece is that they're reasonably secure. So biometrics are inherently you. My love for this particular image is not statistically unique to me, but it is inherently me. I love this image. I put it in every presentation I can because I think it's hilarious. And some people laugh, and they think it is too. So it is not inherently me. Biometrics are better than some of its predecessors because you can be inherently you, statistically you, right? The important thing about biometrics is that they are statistically unique. There's some similarities, but in the real world, it's very difficult to find a matching fingerprint, which is why they're oftentimes used for identification. Retina scan, same thing. Facial scan, same thing. with the exception of twins, but there's ways to get around that. But if you take a look at like the predecessors, where they would try and do multi-factor authentication by getting you to select an image, things of those aren't necessarily inherently you, but it is part of your history, and they can be deterministic and find those things out. Because the problem with people is that they do the same things. They're not distinct or unique. They have bias. So this is a really terrifying statistic. It's based on a password database, a public password database from stolen passwords, and the research of that, and that nearly 17% of the users in those stolen passwords, which are, I believe, 5 million user accounts and passwords, have the password 123456. So just the fact that 17% have the same password, it tells you about a bias. People, first of all, people hate passwords, and they want to do the most, the easiest thing they can remember, right? So if it has to be six digits, I will put in 123456. If many people, right, on their pin, if they could, it'd be 1234, right? If you love Spaceballs, it's a great joke about luggage. But what it does show is it shows bias. Because I have things that are inherent about me that create my bias. So because I work at a security company, my passwords are impossible to type in. All right? If I have to actually type in my password somewhere, it takes me 10 tries because it is so long and so many digits and characters and special things. But most people, which is what I'm here to talk about and protect, most people, they don't want a difficult password. They just want the easiest thing for them to remember and get through the day and do what they've got to do. But those biases are identifiable. So you can find out certain biases about me by going and looking up my social profiles. All right? You can probably see I'm probably not someone to target because I'm a technology person and I'm an outspoken advocate for security, so my passwords are probably not easy and I probably use multi-factor authentication. But if you're someone else, when you have to go get another account, right, you can just socially determine things and figure out things about them to make it easier to guess their password, right? They can put you into groups. So this individual is likely to have this type of password buildup just by the type of person that they are. There's enough data out there that you can do analytics to determine what type of password will this be. Another nice thing about biometrics is that they can't be unknowingly stolen. So they can be copied, just like many other things, but they can't be stolen. I would probably notice if my thumb was missing. I would probably notice if my iris was missing. Unlike if you have a hard token, unlike if you have a password written down somewhere, those are things that you're not constantly looking for and you might not notice if it disappeared, right? If you have a device that you're using for that. But a biometric, it's part of you, which is the whole idea, it's inherence. It is inherently you and therefore cannot be taken away. It can't be stolen and that makes it really important. They also can't be transferred. So one of the popular ways to do two-factor authentication is through SMS, but there have been some really, really, really high-profile people that have had their Twitter accounts taken over because they're using Twitter digits, which is basically just an SMS message, and they took over their PIN, or they took over their SIM card. Because all you have to do is just be convincing enough to whatever phone carrier you are, because your identifier isn't your actual device, the identifier is the phone number. And the phone number is transferable. So you can transfer that from someone, from one person to another, from one device to another. And that makes it kind of dangerous. Because it's just not that difficult to get a carrier to switch it. They're getting better at it, social engineering, all that type of stuff, but it's something, if you're targeted, it's something that can absolutely happen. The other thing about biometrics is that they're inherently stupid. They don't evolve. So biometrics as a whole aren't changing, right? Because they're inherently you, that biometric, it's part of your evolution. And just like the extinct dodo bird, it's not going to change. Fingerprints haven't changed in the 4,000 years we've been using them for authentication. You can't impose an increased biometric complexity rule. So passwords were like, oh, passwords are terrible and they're easy to crack, so we'll just make them more complex. Right? We can't do that with a fingerprint. You can't do that with an iris. You can't tell it to become more complex. you can somehow, you can evolve the technology that uses them and get better at identifying that thing, but I can't have more swirls on my thumb. Right? That's absolutely impossible. It cannot evolve, and it's going to be the same way today as it is in 10 years, in 50 years, in 100 years. They also can't transform. So without some sort of catastrophic event or some sort of surgery, your biometrics will always be the same. And as such, biometrics has a significant flaw. There's this thing called Moore's Law that says that computing power is going to increase by a percentage every year. But your biometric does not. So the things that you're using to store those biometrics, they don't change. So the ability to duplicate and replicate and then also crack things that are storing them gets better over time while the technology stays the same. And the value of biometrics increases over time, the net value. So when you think about it, the nature of biometrics is that any data store that is acquired holds its value over time. If you steal passwords, and if the people that are storing your passwords do it correctly, within days, those passwords are mostly useless. Because people have gone in, they've said, oh, we've had a breach, we've noticed that our passwords are out on the dark web, please change your password and any other account that might have the same password. Now you're gonna get people that don't read the email, you're gonna get people that don't think about the fact that their email account password is the same as the password on some random site that just got attacked. But for the most part, the majority of the people using, majority of the users on whatever application was penetrated, they're going to change their passwords now they don't have access anymore. So those passwords that they got aren't very useful, which is why password hashing algorithms are really only targeted to make it 3 days. When you look at the minimum security available on a password, you should make sure you give your users at least 3 days, regardless of the technology that's there today. And the important thing, again, is that that password is probably changing. People change their passwords over time. Either they're forced to, or they just do it by force of habit. So the value of a password, a stolen password database, just keeps getting lower and lower and lower, and it plummets quickly over a very large time scale, like a time scale of 50 years. Biometrics, however, the ability to brute force and determine what was necessary to recreate a biometric gets less expensive over time. Right? Moore's Law again, it's getting easier and easier to, if you're using hash-based authentication from the hash because you have only a certain number of identifiable factors in your iris or your thumb that's hash-based. If you're doing that, then the ability to brute force that gets easier and easier over time. Think of it like password hashing, right? Or just hashing in general. 10 years ago, MD5 was fantastic, right? If you needed it for something secure today, you would never use MD5, right? Hopefully you're using something like Blake. Or you're going to be moving to something, you know, in the future that's even going to have to be better because it's going to have to be post-quantum. But what was okay 10 years ago, right, if you've done any encryption, triple DES was perfectly acceptable 10 years ago. Today you would never use it because people would be angry at you because it's not secure. It's too easy to crack. So you could be using the most incredible, the most cutting-edge encryption today in 20 years, you'll be able to crack that on a phone. So because of the fact that the biometric doesn't change, the biometric doesn't get more complex, your ability to take an old database and either hash it or if you're storing the entire thing encrypted to be able to do some fuzzy logic to determine if the values are the same. If I steal your database today, it's probably near impossible for me to crack it if you've done your job correctly. Right, you've got a key, you've got random IVs, or if you're hashing, using random salts and using a good algorithm, you're all good. But in 20 years, if that person's still alive and still accessing things using their biometric, I can crack your database. It's just the way encryption works. So it's super, super important to think about this in a very different way from the things you're used to encrypting. It's almost like PII, right? We're all talking about social security numbers need to be dead because they're everywhere already, right? There needs to be some other way to identify you. Or just any ID that lives with you forever is problematic because once it's leaked, it's dead. But if you can change that, as you can in certain circumstances change a social security number, that's perfectly fine. On a biometric, you can't change that, right? My thumb is my thumb is my thumb, and it'll always be my thumb. And I might be able to switch fingers from time to time, but in certain circumstances, if you get all of your fingerprints stolen, not super helpful. So this is not a drill. This actually happened. June 2015, a lot of people in security either had clearance or applied for clearance or were in the military, you probably know about this, right? The Office of Personnel Management had its database stolen, and it had just millions and millions of records of people's information, including their PII, social security number, date of birth, but it also had 5.6 million fingerprints from people who applied for secret or better. And some of those weren't even the people who applied, some of those were just other people. Because when you do a background check for security, they go and talk to all of the people in your family, they go talk to all of your neighbors, and they go fingerprint some of them. So all of these records were stolen, and they were nice, they gave them, you know, free credit monitoring, but I don't know if that's really gonna help, right? Your credentials have now been compromised, and is compromised forever, right? Until you die, your credentials are now compromised. So because of all these factors, you have to be smart. And your organization needs to be smart. You have to understand the strengths and weaknesses of biometrics. You need to ensure all stakeholders understand the risks, because it's very difficult to explain to people that biometrics aren't a magic device to make transactions faster and everybody's secure. As long as you've got the fingerprint, you're good. It's hard. And three is better than one. Right, so when I'm talking about biometrics used in multi-factor authentication, perfectly fine. Because you have other things there that can change, right? You have some other inherence, you may have a possession factor, you'll have a knowledge factor. All these things together by themselves aren't super secure, but if you put them together, they're fantastically secure. And we are talking about true multi-factor authentication. We're not just talking about, I hear people talk about multi-factor authentication by adding another factor. So now they have two factors. That is not multi-factor authentication. Multi-factor authentication is inherence, knowledge, and possession. You must have all three to be actually multi-factor. And I come from Las Vegas, Nevada, where they actually really care about that, because if you fail your password attempt three times, you have to use multi-factor authentication to log into anything for gambling. The other thing that you can do is decentralize and think about this, right? So the OPM gets hacked, 5 million fingerprints are gone. If you're storing centralized biometrics or a service that you employ for authentication uses centralized biometrics, you're putting your users at risk. It's a defined risk, because if I'm someone who's going to try and steal identities, I'm not going to go one person at a time. I'm going to go find a giant database of identities. Right, that's why it's so rare that people are digging through your garbage looking for stuff or information for your identity. They're going in hacking giant accounts, throwing out these wide nets to find what they can catch, and they get some things that they like. So decentralizing, and there's a reason that it's so big on cryptocurrency, right, is that you're spreading out the risk. You're spreading out what they're gonna have to do. If I wanted to go get a million identities one at a time, that'd be very expensive. And it's already the future. So the World Wide Web Consortium and the FIDO Alliance, FIDO is a big word nowadays because of multi-factor authentication, they're coming out with what's called FIDO 2, which uses web authorization, which is decentralized multi-factor authentication. So these specifications are coming out and people are going to start supporting them. They're already supported in the browsers. So if you do B2C, the ability to log in using multi-factor authentication through your browser, as long as it is Edge or Firefox or Chrome, is already built into the next version of the browser coming out. Now, having people that can provide you with the multi-factor authentication providers, that's coming, but it's going to be there. And if you're doing any kind of large installation, you've got a year before it goes out anyway, so you might as well get started now. The other thing that you can do is be smart through machine learning. Identify risk. So we talked about the fact that people love biometrics because they can really quickly go through and make the determination that they're going to authenticate, right? It removes all of the friction for authenticating, which is great when you trust the person doing the authentication. When you get really smart, you can use machine learning to determine how risky this particular authentication is. How risky is this particular transaction? How risky is the place they're doing it from? Whether the place that they're actually doing the transaction, and how risky is the device that's doing the authentication. And when you have those factors, you can add some friction for things that are potentially fraud. So if you're concerned that this might not be this individual, right, you probably see this all the time when you go shopping, when you go to your shopping website, whatever that might be, you go there and you can go shopping all day long and it knows who you are and it knows what your preferences are and you're in there and it doesn't ask you to log in because you've logged on this device before. It's seen that browser and you're going along happy as can be. The second you try and actually order something, it wants you to log in. Or the second that you want to actually look at a previous order, do something on the account, it's going to make you log in because now you're risky. Looking at a shop, you know, looking at what someone buys isn't super risky on a device they've used before. You can do that with any type of application just by identifying the risk factors associated with a particular authentication, whether that's transactional or whether it's some sort of login. The information is there, if you capture it and you utilize it, to determine if you want, hey, I don't want any factors at all. I've seen this before, just let them through. They were here 5 minutes ago. They did a very good transaction. They just authenticated, I'm good. Or you decide that they're at the top left with the red and you go, I've never seen this device before and this is a login from a country this person's never been before. And it's a device that doesn't make any sense because the operating system version and the browser version don't match, right? It's impossible. So you can then say, no, I want you to do all three factors of authentication. And you can step that up one by one. So you need to be able to cover yourself because I know, and I've worked with on the sales side of building sales applications that they just want people to finish. Their whole life and their whole world is finding out how to get them to click that button to buy, right? Reducing all the possible friction to make sure they just get through and hit that buy button because that is what your job depends on. But it's also important that when they hit that buy button that you don't get a chargeback. It's also important that when someone transfers money between things and you charge them a fee for doing that, that that's actually going from the person it's supposed to go to and to the person it goes to. So again, you need to be smart so that you could move those things together, which allows you to be sexy, secure, and smart, right? Again, biometrics by themselves are not super smart. You add in multi-factor authentication, right? You make biometrics a part of multi-factor authentication. You decentralize credentials to protect the users, to protect the identities of the people that you're using. And you enter in risk-based factor requirements. So how many factors of multi-factor authentication? Do I need true multi-factor authentication, or can I just have them add in another piece to make sure that they are who I think that they are? Gets you sexy, secure, and smart. That is the end of the talk part of my presentation, and I wanted to make sure I left plenty of time for questions because I usually get a lot of questions about decentralization. So if you'd like to ask a question, they would ask that you please go to a microphone, which is there, and ask a question. Excellent.
You totally called it. I wanted to ask about decentralization. So I've been talking to a lot of people, and there's a huge buzz around omnichannel, where I, as an end user, I don't want any friction. So I don't want you to ask me for my fingerprint multiple times if I have multiple devices, if I'm just trying to do whatever, banking, for example, or facial record, or whatever it is, any kind of biometric. And I'm kind of torn right now between deciding whether I want my omnichannel or FIDO compliance. So how do you incorporate omnichannel into this whole decentralization concept?
So the decentralization isn't for the identity, it's for the credentials. So when you're doing the, when you're adding in the risk-based factor requirements, so it's, oh, you're doing this process, right? And you always do it the same way, right? If you put in some machine smarts that are out there and you say, look, I've seen this device, it's made this order before, or it's done this type of transaction, and it's coming from the same browser, and it's having the same characteristics of performing the transaction, then I'm not gonna ask you because it's perfectly fine. You do this all the time, it's a normal thing. When you get out of the realm of normal, that's when I'm going to say, whoa, now we need to do some multi-factor authentication because I need to verify that this is you because this is an odd behavior. Kind of how right now where if you came here and you actually stayed at some of the hotels and they put a $500 a night charge on there and your credit card company says, hey, you just did a $500 a night charge at a hotel, your hotel stays are usually not that expensive. And they verify that it's actually me doing it. It's the same kind of thing, although it costs a lot less. They don't have to call you, and you can get it done pretty quickly. But again, as doing a dangerous thing can do that where you have to do the multi-factor authentication, but doing something very normal, very usual doesn't happen, and that's through the centralized data store of machine learning and your habits. It's just the credentials you're going to keep decentralized.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? I got question row over here. Oh, sorry, and they want you to introduce yourself. I apologize.
The advantage of a password is that if it gets compromised, you can revoke it. Now, even if it's decentralized, iPhone, whatever, that comes with your fingerprint you can put on your iPhone, it means that there is a copy of your fingerprint or a hash of your fingerprint in the device, in case a malware or whatever stores this information on your device. It means you cannot compromise anymore your fingerprint. It means you cannot use it, anymore, and you can be impersonated forever. Is it correct?
So that is correct. So then he was speaking a little softly, but he said, so, and this is a question I get a lot. So if you have your device and it has your credentials and someone's able to attain your device or clone your device and then attack it and get the information out of it, they're going to be able to, again, get your fingerprint or your facial scan or your retina and then be able to use that credential forever. And you're correct. But in order for that to happen, I have to make a very directed attack at you as an individual. So there are certain individuals that are, I'm normally not that type of person that would get that kind of attack, but there are individuals I know that need to protect themselves against that kind of attack. So they are much more cautious to the devices they use and how they store their credentials and what's available there. And these are also people that will have a very long password on the encryption for their device. The thing that I'm most concerned about, right? And so there are people that are targets and they're hopefully being secure, right? US government, you're required to use a BlackBerry for just that reason, because it's more secure than an iPhone. Places that I've worked, you're required to use an iPhone because it's a bit more secure than most of the Android devices. You get to make that choice. So, but I, as a consumer, if you're storing my credentials centrally, I don't get to choose how you store that. I have to make some certain assumptions that you're storing it well, but the likelihood that someone would just pick me up in a much larger net is very high with centralized. So the majority of the people on the planet who aren't really necessarily a target, they're not, their credentials aren't important enough to be a specific target, those are the people that are most often caught up in these giant nets. And those are the people that I'm most concerned about, right? It's you, it's me, it's our families, it's people that we, our neighbors, people that we see, people that aren't, the head of a major corporation, they don't work for the government. Those are the people that aren't going to have to necessarily be so concerned about somebody trying to steal their identity by taking their device and going through the expense of having to crack one of those. Those are the ones that are gonna get caught up in these giant nets, like the OPM, where they're unknowingly caught up because someone took all of their identity information from a giant store of data. Where passwords, Again, once the passwords are stolen from the data store, you know that. You can tell people, when passwords are stolen, they tell you, change your password. When your PII or your biometrics are stolen, you're told that you get free protection from identity theft for the rest of your life. So there's a very different game that's being played between the two. Does that answer your question?
Yes, certainly. But I'm just thinking in the financial sector, if you use a fingerprint to approve a transaction, for instance, even as an individual, you can become a target.
Correct. But again, on the other side, is if you add in full multi-factor authentication, it's not just the biometric. Right? So if you were to, for all the things that I do, if you were to steal my fingerprint, and because I'm a very secure individual, I have multi-factor authentication turned all the way up, where I require that I have to have my watch. So they would not only have to take my device to get my fingerprint, they would also have to take my watch, they'd have to take my phone, they'd have to crack my phone to be able to use my phone and figure out what my large, long PIN is and able to be able to prove that transaction. So again, biometrics are stupid because they can't change, they can't evolve, and it's always going to be there, they don't change, but if you put it in a true multi-factor authentication process, then you're able to protect yourself, whether it's stolen locally, whether it's stolen remotely. You take all those pieces together, which they accent each other in a fashion to where the things that are necessarily bad about each one is kind of, it is resolved by the fact that it's got another piece that's better. Question?
The question that I have about a credentials reset or password reset and the security questions to help in the process. So do you have a recommendation on what would be the examples of good security questions, something that doesn't change over time, like what's your favorite movie, or is not something that could be found in a social media, what's the name of your dog, what's the name of your son, something like that. Do you have any recommendation?
So most of these things, when you get those, if you didn't enter, what I prefer, if you want a security question, let someone specify it themselves, because I just come up with random phrases, right? I have my former coworker actually just use random strings, but then people go, oh, this must be wrong, you're good, because it was just a random string. So I just make up random phrases. But a lot of times what you're getting is you're getting a service that's going through, and they're verifying your identity by going and finding public records. Something like a LexisNexis search, where they're doing that. So I really prefer the ability, because most of the things found on LexisNexis are public records, therefore I could just go look at Facebook, or I can go to the public records myself if I wanted to attack you and do that. So I'm not a fan of resetting in that fashion, because you can definitely just kind of sweet talk people into just letting you do it anyway, for the most part. But if you're going to do the security questions, let them provide the questions and answers themselves, so that I put in, like I said, just random information so that no one could ever guess it. You can't socially engineer that, but I can store that in my password manager so I can remember it for later.
So what would be the alternative to security questions?
The alternative to security questions, so for multi-factor authentication, I don't have to reset. So if it's a local device and you're storing the information there, I can just disassociate that device. Now, I personally have two devices, so I have a backup, but then it's really going to depend on your particular situation, on what that's going to go through. So on a bank, you may want to just say, okay, tell me what the fourth entry was on your bank statement, right? Something that someone's not gonna be able to figure out. You probably have that record somewhere that you can figure it out. Or there's things that are very specific to the information that you have that's not just public knowledge. But again, not everybody can do that, which is why the public questions, you know, the security questions are so popular, is because it's just something that you can do that's super easy. Hopefully you're storing that information hashed in the database, not necessarily encrypted. You just need to match it. You don't need to ever read it. I guess unless you're doing a call center. But yeah, storing in plain text, please don't do that. Question?
Do you see privacy concerns becoming an issue for trying to implement risk-based factor requirements in the future, though?
So that question came up specifically with GDPR, with my company, and that, so there's certain information that can just be simply anonymized. So I'm not worrying about you as an individual, I'm just worrying, is this device? So our customers send us device information and they say, hi, our customer's trying to do an authentication request with this device. Here's the hash of our customer, and here's the device that they're trying to do this on, and we determine that, oh yes, this user, this anonymous user, has made this particular information, has made these types of requests before, here and there. We don't give them access to when they do that, although they already know what they did. But again, it's and GDPR could be a fantastic thing for everyone, right? If you just anonymize the data that is personally identifiable, so I can't track where you've been, what you've done, but I can anonymize you so that I can't track it directly to you. Or if you're just looking for kind of statistical data, you can anonymize the statistical part, which we also do, is, you know, how often are transactions, are bad transactions made at a certain location, to add that to the risk.
So you're saying you can, there are techniques to make it one way, so you can't always trace it back to a particular individual.
Correct. Right. So, and we don't even trust our customers. We actually just hash what they give us, because sometimes they don't give us anonymized stuff, which is bad, because we have to, you know, for GDPR and for PCI, we have to say, no, we don't have any credit card numbers, which sometimes people send as account numbers. It's not a good idea. Or we also have to say that we don't have anything else which could be their state identifier or whatever might be for that particular country, your unique identifier for that, which we don't want ever to get either. So we now just hash all the data that comes in so that we can't identify that with you personally. We just know that there's a device that matches this particular user that's coming from a customer of ours.
Thanks.
Any more questions? And if you do ask a question, they want you to introduce yourself. You can make up a fake name. I'm totally cool with that. As there are so many. Hello, my name is Jane Doe, and I have a question. Any more questions? Awesome.
Hi, my name is John. Question is, when you're combining the biometrics with another multi-factor like a password, you're probably less concerned about the need to change the password, right?
Absolutely. So in our particular solution, you never have to change your PIN. That's up to you. If you want to change your PIN, you're more than welcome to. We'd never make the requirement to do that. And if you look at password studies, you can see that if I have to change my password constantly, I'm going to come up with a scheme that I'll be able to remember. It'll be some sort of root plus a month, right? If I have to change it every 3 months, I might put a quarter, I might say spring, right? Password 123 spring, password 123 fall. Where if you don't require people to change it, they can make up long phrases, which are absolutely susceptible to dictionary attack, but as long as the phrase is long enough, it's plenty secure, and it's nearly impossible to crack. And the likelihood that it's going to be gotten out there is pretty slim. But again, if someone were to somehow get your password through bad use, once you add in possession and you add in inheritance, all those bad things go away, because someone can steal your password, but they can't steal your thumb. And if they get my watch, I'll notice, right? So.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Another question.
Hi, my name is Eric. You stated that biometrics are static, you can't change them. My understanding is that that's not entirely true. I believe there are studies that have shown that your irises can change if you get certain diseases, or if you have like cataract surgery, for example. What's your perspective on that?
So, and I actually did say it in the slide, unless you have some sort of catastrophic event or you have some sort of surgery to modify it, it's not going to change. What it's not going to do is like a password where I can say, oh, someone's got my iris, let me change my iris. Or someone's got my thumb, let me change my thumb. And the other thing I was saying is it's not going to evolve, where it's not going to be, wow, it's super easy to crack. I can't count them right now, but it's a very small finite number of swirls that you have on your thumb. We need more swirls so that we can get more complex. That's never going to happen. But there are going to be, you know, there are certain things that can happen to your face that you might need to go recheck yourself on your facial recognition. But overall, for the things that are super popular, like the facial recognition is really just kind of coming in with 3D cameras and things like that on the device. Not so much for any kind of centralized store, because it's just a picture versus a picture, which isn't all that great. But for your thumb, your thumb's not going to change a lot. And if it does, then you're going to have to go re-register that and kind of go from there. But again, most people, these things don't change. Right? And there's always going to be edge cases. Right, and in, you have to make a decision on security, and this is the thing I talk about a lot, is that you have to figure out who you're protecting from and what you're going to be okay with. Because if you want to protect against everything, right? If you want to make sure that no device can ever be compromised, and you want to make sure that nobody can ever leak anything and no password ever goes anywhere, right? There are options for you to go inside of a Faraday cage and work inside of there without any devices. Like, I mean, then there are security situations where that is absolutely necessary. That you have a guard making sure that that's your thumb, and they do all the crazy things to make sure that you are who you are. But for most of us, we're just trying to be reasonably sure that this is the individual that we want, that we're doing our best efforts to protect our company, our customers, whatever that may be, so that we can provide the best, reasonably affordable solution that can get out there and protect people as best we can.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? Coming around.
I used to work for a company called Pay by Touch here, and it was biometrics for a point of sale thing. And at the time, this was years ago, it was about 1 in 10,000. They thought, you know, was a safe factor as far as how often, you know, someone else's fingerprint would look to yours. So, has that evolved? I would think it has, as far as reading. And it's not so much your finger doesn't change, but the information on your finger. So, does that vary based on what company you're having your finger captured by as to how safe or unsafe it is?
Well, what I can say, there's another fantastic example of why you need decentralized biometrics is because on that device, right, that decentralized piece, the likelihood that they're gonna be able to find somebody that's gonna be able to do that. So we're not talking about doing identity verification via biometrics, we're just talking about authentication. So identity is a whole other thing that I don't do and I don't get into because that's much more difficult. What I can tell you is that the capture technology on the devices has gotten much better. So if you're doing non-centralized, or if you're doing centralized biometric validation, that means you're taking a picture of your thumb and you're shipping it off, which I can duplicate a picture of a thumb. The devices that we have that have gotten so popular, they're using special technology to get a 3D image to make sure that, yes, there's actually ridges there, that I can determine that the ridges are, the depth is similar. It's doing a lot of complicated things to make sure I'm not just looking at a picture of a thumb, or trying to duplicate it from being able to take the image from the oils and being able to pick that up, just like you pick up a fingerprint if you're doing an investigation and turn that into a fingerprint. It's much more difficult to do that because the way that the ridges are built is very difficult. So it's actually pretty hard to duplicate a fingerprint that can go on the scanners. Yes, that's one of the reasons that if you have problems with water is because it's making sure that it's conductive. So it's an actual finger. Or something that's also conductive. But they actually make gloves now, tips you can put on gloves for doing that kind of stuff too. It's going to copy it and then make you use it, which is scary and dangerous all at the same time. Any other questions? Right, so the comment was is that it's a difficult sell to get rid of passwords because passwords are things people understand. Passwords are things people already have built into their applications. Doing multi-factor authentication is an out-of-band process, which is difficult to work with sometimes. And trying to sell multi-factor authentication products, I've had this problem. And one of the things that we've also found is that, look, you're not going to get everybody to move to multi-factor authentication, right? Some people are there, you know, there's a technology gap at certain points where you're unable to do that. There's the fact that not everybody may have a device, things like that. But what we have found is that if you say give them an option, right? Like right now, I don't have to use my fingerprint or my thumbprint to get into my banking app on my phone, but I can. It's something that I choose. And so giving users a choice and letting them move towards that, it gives you more. And another option is just like show them a bunch of research about how terrible passwords are for breaches. Well, compliance is actually going the other way with multi-factor on a lot of things. So a lot of compliance things are requiring multi-factor authentication to be able to access certain types of data, but it depends on the data that you've got.
But they still have the password
Agreed. Correct. We're talking about bad password behavior by making them rotate. If you NIST has actually said, nah, you don't have to do it. So the standards are evolving, thanks to people like Per Torsheim doing his wonderful password work. But if you have any more questions, sorry, we've reached the end. If you have any more questions, I'm down at downstairs, down by the bathrooms in the back. Just look for Bigfoot, and I'll be there if you want to have more questions.